What we're going to talk about today are sets of positive numbers, okay? And a set is basically just a collection of positive integers. And what we're going to do is try to add sets together. So let's say we have a set that's called A, and we'll write the notation, and I'll give an example. This set is 2, 3, 7. Let's have another example. We'll call it B, and we'll say that B is 1, 5, 8, and 9. What we want to do is add these two sets together. And so what do I mean by that? What we're gonna do is add each number in the set pairwise. So I'll say that A plus B is equal to 1 plus 2, 1 plus 3, 8 plus 3 plus 2, 9 plus 3, and 9 plus 7. Right, we have a new set, and we would like to write out the sums so that we actually know what our set is. So let's say 12, and finally 16. Well, we have some repeated numbers here, so we would like to just write the set in its actual form. So I just struck out the repeated numbers that we had. So another thing worth noting here is that in our set A, we had 3 members, in our set B, we had 4 members, and in our set, the sum of A and B, we had 9 members. And this is something that'll come up again. We can think of a special type of set that I'll call an arithmetic progression. So an arithmetic progression could be P equal 4, 8, 12, say 16, say 20. We add 4 each time to the number before it, and we have a progression. And it's called an arithmetic progression because we added the numbers. What we'll do is we'll add P to itself, and we'll see what happens, and something kind of interesting kind of happens. And so again, we have 4 plus 4, 4 plus 8. We have this large set of sums here, and in fact, the actual set will be much smaller. 8, see, 12, 16, 36, and 40.
That's the final
set.
Came down quite a lot, didn't it? Is it normal for sets to come down that much?
No, it's not normal. So if we have a set of integers, we add all of the sums. We have, you saw we had a lot of sums. In most cases, maybe there's not too much overlap. And in that case, we have something close to what we had originally, this whole large grid of sums. The nice thing about an arithmetic progression added to itself is that the size of the sum set will be less than 2 times the size of the original set. The sum set will never double the size of the original set. What you'll end up having is that the size of P plus P is always less than or equal to 2 times the size. And that's special. We can do it in another example where we get pretty much the exact opposite. Maybe our size of P plus P is actually closer to what we would expect with no overlap. So what we're gonna do next are geometric sequences. I'll call it G this time. And this set will be 2, 4, 8, and 16. This is 2 to the 1, 2 squared, 2 cubed, and this is 2 to the 4. So I'll add G to itself, this geometric sequence to itself, and what's special about geometric sequences is that they're pairwise sums. We have some overlap. We have some overlap here, but we don't have overlap as much as we do in the case of the arithmetic progressions. So the size of G originally is size 4, and the size of G plus G is now equal to 10.
So that's more than doubled.
Yes, definitely more than double, right? So now we have the size of G plus G greater than 2 times the size of G. And if we were to take a really large geometric sequence, we would actually see that G plus G is about G squared. The first thing is a result from Pauler addition. It's a little bit about some sets. Okay, so let's say we take a set 2, 3, and 7. We can define the notion of a set being sum free. And what do I mean by sum free? I mean that if you take any pair of numbers in your set, including the number itself, add it to itself, then the sum of the pair of numbers is not in the set. So let's look at A plus A.
Yep.
And so this will be 4, 5, 9, 10, and 14. You see that no numbers are shared between these two sets. Okay, so A is sum-free.
Are sum-free sets common, or are they like a special rarity? Like, are they like prime numbers, or are sum-free sets easy to find?
You would think that they would be maybe uncommon, but in fact they're actually more common than you would imagine. So let's say you have any set, okay, any set of positive integers. What Paul Erdős said is that there exists a subset of that arbitrary set that you picked that is sum-free, and that subset is greater than 1/3 of the size of the original set. Yeah, I have a favorite fractal set, I'll say, and that's it's inside of an interval of real numbers. So let's say you have an interval of real numbers, 0 to 1.
So we're not dealing with integers anymore.
We're not dealing with integers anymore. We have a set of real numbers. What I would like to, I guess, construct is something that's called the Cantor middle third set. It's an iterative process. And the first step of the Cantor middle third set is you take the middle third out of the interval 0, 1, okay? So you find the middle third of 0, 1. And so this goes from 1/3 to 2/3. And you erase that segment of the interval. What I have left is this set, okay?
It's still infinitely big.
Yeah, if you just count the elements in the set, it's huge, it's uncountable. And so now, the second step is to take the middle thirds out of the segments that we have left. So we take a third of this set, a third. And so we end up with something a little smaller. You do it again, and you do it infinitely many times, I suppose. And the last and the limit set that you end up with is called the Cantor middle third set.
But you never get there. How would you ever get there?
Well, you approximate it, basically. You say that it's, the thing that if you get close enough or you take an arbitrarily large step in our progression, that'll be the closest set to it. That'll be the limit.
How many numbers are in the Cantor middle third set?
Well, there are uncountably many, okay? And so, in some sense, you can say that we haven't taken the size down at any point, but there is a way to measure how much we've taken away. In general, we'll say that the interval, I suppose, is just a line. If we want to measure the dimension of the interval, we can say that the dimension is 1, right? So the dimension, just like the dimension of this piece of paper, should be, it's not actually 2, right? Because it has some thickness. But in some fantasy world, it's 2, right? We're in 3 dimensions, right? Okay, so the dimension of the line should just be 1, or the interval should be just be 1. And there's some way to measure the dimension of this Cantor 1/3 set. And what I'll just say it here, and I'll call it dimension in quotations. And I'll say that the dimension of Cantor set, log 2 over log 3.
Number 5 is brought to you by the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute, MSRI. That's the building behind me there. This is a place where many of the world's top mathematicians come together for sometimes a semester at a time, cracking some of the hardest problems in mathematics. If you'd like to find out more, I'll put some links in the description under the video.